They're number one across the world.
Can you handle a Spice Girl?
Anyone can be a Spice Girl. She who dares win. Make it
last forever. Yeah! Watch out, lads.
Girls in here.
What you looking at, boy? Girl power's coming at ya.
Add some spice to your life with the Spice Girls debut album out now.
Spice Girls were on the Beatles level of popularity, but nobody wants to look back at them. The Spice Girls are so ubiquitous, yet pop culture, poptimists, historical re-evaluations, they won't go near the Spice Girls. We're in the middle of a late 90s revival and nobody wants to touch the Spice. One Direction have had more cultural reassessment. The Jonas Brothers have been less ignored by critics. Well, it's time for me to right this wrong. The Spice Girls are inseparable from the 90s, with their initial run going from 1996 to 2001, but the bulk of their impact happening in the first 2 years, 96 through 98. They used that time very well. I think it's fair to say that in their short time in the spotlight, Mel C, Mel B, Emma Bunton, Jerry Halliwell, and Victoria Adams changed music forever. But Spice Girls were about more than just the music. They were a cross-cultural phenomenon. They had 3 albums and a movie and a lot of frankly very funny merchandise. So today, I'm going to spice up your life. I'm going to give you everything. But we have to start at the start. We have to go back to the 90s with... The world had its first taste of spice in 1996 with their debut single, Wannabe. And what an introduction it was. We've got a video where Baby Spice goes up to a homeless person, says "Ah," and then steals his fucking hat. Emma, that's not on. That's not how you deal with homeless people. This video is going to go pretty in depth as to why the Spice Girls were able to rocket so fast and so high in the public consciousness. But the first and most obvious reason is just how good Wannabe is as a song. Listening to this song sounds like having a hammer dropped on your head. The girls were actively involved in the songwriting process, and they had such a strong vision for what they wanted that the result is an iconic song made up of constituent iconic pieces. Here are my top 5.
Number 5.
Clip clop, clip clop, clip clop. Ha ha ha.
Number 4.
Here's a story from A to Z. If you want to be my lover, you have to get with my friends.
Jerry and Mel's call and response.
And my number one musical moment is when Scary Spice says, "And as for me, ha ha, you'll see." I've just always wondered what she meant by that. Look at all of these territories it went to number one in. It even went sextuple platinum in Italy.
Wow!
So we have established that the music is undeniably great, but I would also like to posit that the music video helped introduce the world to the Spice Girls in the most favourable way. And here's why.
The original plan for the video
was to take place during the daytime in Barcelona. There would have been this sunny, exotic building. They'd storm through it and there'd be sexy Spanish men. Sounds like a great music video. Problem is, 5 days before the shoot, the director says, don't have permission. So low on time and low on budget, they relocate to the London St. Pancras Hotel at night. This saves the video, but there's an unintended side effect. It's much colder than they were expecting. In a recent study published by the American Psychological Association, it was found that men and women both project more positive emotions onto women who have nipple erections. Furthermore, a follow-up study stated that men perceived women with nipple erections as more deserving of altruism, and they also believed that women with erect nipples were more deserving of being included into their social groups. Yo! Am I saying that the Spice Girls' success depended on the fact that they had pointy nipples? No. But they did have pointy nipples? The Spice Girls have cited both TLC and Madonna as big influences on their musical style. And while you can hear the influence of TLC's New Jack Swing and contemporary R&B on their debut record, in my opinion, the influence of TLC mostly manifests in the form of TLC's sass and attitude. You can draw a direct line from that to this. So here's a story from A to Z. You wanna get with me? You gotta listen carefully. We got M in the place, who likes it in your face. You got G like MC, who likes it on a easy B, who doesn't come for free. She's a real lady. And as for me, haha, you'll see. And as for me, haha, you'll see. That verse is about their attitudes to sex. What does haha, you'll see mean? Is Mel B going to sleep with me? Interestingly, record label executives argued against releasing Wannabe as the debut single, but the Spice Girls fought back on the matter and Wannabe was eventually released as the debut single. And it's a good thing too, because Wannabe was a mission statement. Wannabe was a manifesto. Wannabe was the Spice Girls looking directly into the camera of popular culture and saying, we like to fuck on MDMA. And popular culture looked back at the Spice Girls and said, yeah, that's a vibe. If you close your eyes and think of UK pop music of the 90s, you're probably thinking of Today. Or maybe you're thinking of. But in actual fact, the UK pop music of the 90s is a lot more fucked than you remember. To blame, keep my mom, she thinks I'm crazy, but I got to rescue Daisy. Memory seems to have done a funny thing to 90s music, because in my head, Oasis sort of rules the world in 1995, 1996. But in reality, if you look at the best-selling songs, they're all the way down here. And then at the top, you have this really cheesy electronic shite. That's the fourth best-selling song of 1996. That's the third best-selling song of 1995. If you look at the charts in 1996, you can see that tastes in the UK were starting to change.
If you look just below the Spice Girls on the best-selling singles of 1996, you'll see The Fugees and Mark Morrison. It's important to remember that in the UK popular consciousness, rapping entered as a part of dance music, not of hip-hop or R&B. The lyrics will flow, yo, for the words I speak. Rap is weak, so I teach and I reach. A positive vibe, a way of life is how I'm living. So get hype to the rhythm. But by 1996, the UK had got a taste for what was going on over the pond. All this is to say that it was a really good time for the Spice Girls to rip off the G-Funk sound. Riding a wave of hype from Wannabe, and with a very fashionable sound, the track debuted at number one. Once again, the confidence of the girls comes out in the track, as they are saying exactly what they want from a man. It's also the first time that the world got to hear Mel C's over-singing, which is the secret weapon of Spice Girls songwriting. Going back to this track now, I don't super like it, like there's a really weird solo in it, but like I get it, I get why this was popular. That's a slick music video that they've got, so, and they, I do like those latex suits, man. This was followed by Two Become One, which also debuted at number one and became the fastest selling single of 1996.
Spice.
The first three songs on 1996's Spice are, in order, the first three singles. I mean, there's nothing wrong with that, but if that's how you want to do it, I guess. This is the point in the video where I give you my unironic critical opinion of the Spice Girls' first album. I quite like it.
Just as they opened their career with Wannabe, and I opened this video with Wannabe, they also opened their album with Wannabe. And it works just as well as an album opener as it does as a career opener. The album is broadly divided into two types of songs. The high energy pop, like Wannabe, and slower R&B jams like Two Become One.
Two Become One is the first Spice Girls song that doesn't really work for me, and I'll explain why. The song is built on this intimate, virginal theme of how special it is when two bodies come together and become one. But the Spice Girls had already come in guns blazing with a we like to shag casually kind of attitude, so it's hard to walk it back from that. But there's also the problem that there's five girls singing it, and your mind races when you start thinking about what that means for the song. But also, just technically, I don't like the breathy singing throughout. I don't think it plays to the girls' strengths as singers. The first album cut after Two Become One is Love Thing, and this song is a lot better in terms of how it relates to the Spice Girls' image, I think. This is another song with a strong girl gang energy, where they are asking, nay demanding, that a man give them what they want, and it isn't that love thing. And like in Wannabe, there's just a lot of ideas packed into the space. They use the time so well, and there is an infectious energy that comes off of it. With a girl's name Spice, you wanna get with us, then you better think twice. God help the mister. Yeah, God help the mister that comes between me and my sisters.
The next track shows the same sexual confidence, but at a slowed down, simmering, saucy tempo. Cool and sexy. The girls know that you want to get with them. Cool and sexy. I just like how they say it. But the girls are not just cool and sexy. They also love their mums. This is the fourth single they released, and certainly the most on the nose lyrically, but it's... there's just something I can't hate about it. There aren't very many songs about apologizing to your parents for being a stroppy teenager, and maybe there should be. Teenage rebellion is overrepresented in pop music. We need more pop songs about how your parents are wiser than you and just doing what's best. The song also has a flute line, which is taken directly from Talking Heads' This Must Be the Place. I'm not accusing them of being a ripoff. I just really like the Talking Heads and wanted to mention it. Their undisputed masterpiece is Who Do You Think You Are? A song so catchy that most people probably don't listen to the lyrics. But they should, because it's not just about the pleasures of being a pop star, it's also a put down of a man. You've got the bug, superstar, you've been bitten. Your trumpet's blowing for far too long. Climbing the snake up the ladder, but you're wrong. There's just something timelessly endearing about a well-deserved fuck you, I'm a pop star type song. And it is well deserved at this point. They had 4 number one singles and their album was number one. But it's crazy that this song was recorded before all of that. They just sell it so well. And I personally really like a good rhetorical question in song lyrics. And Who Do You Think You Are? That's an all-timer. That's up there with Do You Think You're Better Off Alone? And the lyrics and the confident performance are paired with maybe the best beat of the Spice Girls' career, brought to them by the production team of Absolute. And those are the guys that inspired Massive Attack to work with everything but the girls' Tracy Thorn. So, there's a bit of music history for you. Following that sing-along anthem, we have Something Kinda Funny. While I felt that Say You'll Be There was a little bit too much of a cheesy pastiche of G-Funk, Something Kinda Funny, on the other hand, has such a tight groove that I'm all chips in on it. There's a cultural tradition in Britain that British people and American people love it when British people take American culture and sort of do it again, but filtered through this lens of Britishness. And that's the trick that the Spice Girls are pulling on this album, filtering American R&B through the lens of British youth culture of the 90s. And then they go and end the album with Jerry rapping gibberish in Spanish. Hey chico, tú no tienes nada. Qué susto, qué soco, qué polla, qué pienso. Oh, no me toques. Ay, qué pero feo. Venga, venga, marcha, salida. Toma esa música, me canta de prisa. Cuidado. Anyway, as that's the last track, time for me to wrap up my thoughts on the album. Now, I don't want to say that the Spice Girls are underrated, but there is something weird going on that people will listen to Taylor Swift and Carly Rae Jepsen and take it super seriously as art music. But for some reason,
that is not afforded to the Spice Girls. And like, new music listeners are not being put on to this, and they are getting put on to fucking, like, Rebecca Black. What's going on there? And it's extra weird to me because of how much of a cultural juggernaut the Spice Girls were. Like, how is something that popular, that ignored? It continues to confuse me. The received wisdom of the Spice Girls is that they are manufactured and inauthentic, and that critics never took them seriously. But if you look at the reviews at the time, there's an interesting story in that they weren't initially dismissed.
NME put Spice, the album, in their top 50 albums, and Wannabe, the single, actually placed higher than Aphex Twin's Girl Boy EP in the end of year list.
It was even nominated for a Mercury Prize.
That's not to say that there wasn't suspicion. Rolling Stone notably put them in a lineage alongside Take That and New Kids on the Block. But generally, they were accepted by the music establishment. It wasn't until they went sicko mode on merchandise production that people really started to get wary of them. And that brings me on to...
Much was made about the empowering ethos of girl power. What did it mean? Was it feminist? Was it not feminist? What did it mean? Well, if you turn to page 6 on the official Girl Power Manual, you can find out. Girl power is when you help a guy with his bag. You and your mates reply to wolf whistles by shouting, "Get your ass out!" You wear high heels and think on your feet. You know you can do it and nothing's going to stop you. You don't wait around for him to call. You stick with your mates and they stick with you. You're loud and proud, even when you broke out in spots. You believe in yourself and control your own life. And that last one is in pink, so that's the most important rule of girl power.
You may be wondering what the official Spice Girl Girl Power Guide says about girl power's relationship with feminist ideology.
Feminism has become a dirty word. Girl power is just a 90s way of saying it. We can give feminism a kick up the arse. Women can be so powerful when they show solidarity. And you know how I mentioned that this book was official? Well, there was quite a lot of official Spice Girls merchandise. Let's take a look at the world of merch and spice. After they'd blasted the doors open and become the hottest band in Britain, they decided that they wanted to capitalise on their success, and capitalise they did. They hired the guy who had been in charge of merchandising for Manchester United, and with his help, there were books, stickers, backpacks, best-selling dolls, lunchboxes, mugs, fine china, chupa chups, cameras, magazines, biscuits, napkins, crisps, a PlayStation 1 game, and a massive brand deal with Pepsi. Of all of their brand deals, perhaps the largest was Pepsi. Peep these sick Pepsi fits. I would kill a man to own that sweet Pepsi merchandise. They even struck a promotional deal where people could send in tabs from Pepsi cans to get a CD single of a song that wasn't good enough to make the album. Why don't you? So, if you see a bunch of Pepsi shit later on in this video, and you will, do not be afraid. Don't be afraid. You know how this video has taken a little while to come out? Well, something happened. I can't give you a good explanation or rationalization, but I converted my spare room into a shrine to the Spice Girls. Well, it's time to show you the Spice Room. On the door of the Spice Room, we have this Pepsi Music Presents the Spice Girls poster. Now, I like this because the green screen cannot handle Mel's hair,
and basically none of the girls look like they're having a good time, which sets the tone very well for the rest of the room. Now, as we come in, this is going to be quite a lot to take in, so we're just going to focus on one thing at a time. We have the official Spice Girls Spice Girl photos. I now have more photos of the Spice Girls than I do my friends or family. We have the Spice Girls bed with official 1996 Spice Girls Spice sheets. Next to the bed we have Spice Clock. We have my vinyl 12-inch single of Spice Girls Say You'll Be There. Shrine here of Spice Girls reading material. This is the Girl Power Manual that I was reading
Viva
from earlier.
Fairies.
We also have a full copy of the photo album, which many of the photos from my walls are also in there. This was the first book the Spice Girls wrote, but actually this was the second book, and it's much better. You're going to read one official story, Spice Girls, Spice Girls, the figurine. They get this one with a lot of juicy details. This one is kind of padded out with full reanimation. It's nowhere near as bad as the Spice Summer Special,
which is enhanced with the power of the Spice Girls CD.
Save your time, don't call the vibes.
This helps us be the RAM.
We have maybe my most proud part of the Spice Room. The Jerry Halley wall. Yes, thank you. We can move on to this large poster of the Viva Forever Fairies. I find that this brings my guests peace and comfort.
When I want a good night's sleep, I choose the Spice sheets. They provide a level of comfort and relaxation that other sheets just can't match. I wouldn't recommend any other sheets than the Spice sheets. If someone said to me, Phil, how can I get a good night's sleep? I would say, sack off the orthopedic mattress and instead invest in the Spice Sheets. It really is the best night's sleep you'll ever have. Spice Sheets. Buy the Spice Sheets. They're relaxing.
And while we're talking about merchandising, I want to bring up the fact that when they announced their ultimate piece of merchandise, a film, they had the sheer gall to do it at Cannes Film Festival. Cannes! That's the second best can after this refreshing can of Pepsi Cola. This is still sealed. It's older than I am. It comes with fun Spice Girls trivia. However, all of this brand endorsement was not simply to line the girls' pockets. It also acted as a way to break them in new territories. For example, when they worked with Chupa Chups, they used that to help break Spain. And this worked, as Spain became their third largest territory. That's what this rush was about. The first half of 1997 was a blitzkrieg of getting their name out there. There was not a product they would not endorse, or a high-ranking official that they would not flirt with. Here's them with Prince Charles.
I was asking you a question. Can we come to dinner, please?
I don't know.
I don't know.
You've got lipstick on you now. That's alright. I wanted to know where we were. But you know what? I think you're very sexy.
Oh, no!
Good job. You're extremely sexy, actually.
It was at this moment they pinched Prince Charles's arse. If you think that's nuts, check out this clip of when they met Nelson Actual Mandela.
You know, these are my heroines.
And he's our hero as well.
And, I don't want to be emotional, but it's one of the greatest moments in my life.
This man survived a jail sentence, became president, and ended racial apartheid in South Africa.
It's one of the greatest moments in my life.
I'm lost for words. This charm offensive was not limited to the wealthy and powerful,
basically anybody that they talk to, they would lay it on thick.
You're even not the publicist for this film, are you?
I might
be. You're doing a good job.
I'll tell you what, you know, even the intellectual, you know, movie buff like you might enjoy it.
He will enjoy it.
I think so.
Damn. The last time I saw you was on the set of your film.
Don't lie, it was last night.
Yeah.
Indeed, girl power as they deployed it behind the scenes looked slightly different than how they preached it in magazines and albums. Here's a story from when they were trying to get signed. Then, they came into my office, and this whole routine unfolded in front of me. They put on the track that they'd done with Elliot on the cassette player, and they sang along to it karaoke style with this dance routine going on. The whole thing was completely choreographed to turn me on. I remember Emma Bunton had a short skirt and a blouse on, the school uniform looking thing with her hair in bunches. She pulled up a chair opposite me and sat down so I could see up her skirt. And the others were all cavorting and that sort of stuff, and I said, right, this is really impressive. Can we switch it off? Please switch it off. I'm an extremely happily married man and I know exactly what you're doing. This is absolutely brilliant. Please switch it off. And they all went and sat on the settee and said, right, let's get down to business then.
The girls knew how to turn on the charm, and the nation was charmed.
People just liked having them around and working with them and having access to them. The power of the pull of Spice was so heavy. They launched Channel 5 with an exclusive music video that is the most 90s thing that you will ever see.
Welcome to Channel 5 on satellite.
By the way, I just want to shout out the Spice Girls wiki, where if you look up this event, someone has edited Nicki Minaj's Super Bass lyrics into the body of the Wikipedia article, and this has been unchanged since September of last year.
The vocabulary of Spice oozed into British consciousness. It was spice this, spice that, spice it up. The girls' personas as well, ginger, scary, sporty, posh and baby, it was almost too easy to understand. Everybody wanted to talk about it. Everybody was assigned a Spice Girl.
It was so ingrained into British culture that they nearly got Tony Blair, when he was Prime Minister, to have a cameo in the Spice Girls movie where he declares what his favourite Spice Girl is. That's fucking nuts. Culturally, this all comes to a head at the 1997 Brit Awards.
That night, the girls won two awards and were asked to perform live. This performance is, I think, one of the most important awards show performances of all time, and I'm not joking.
Pay attention to how crazy the room goes for the Spice Girls here.
Yes, we all want to be their lover. We're more than happy to be their friend. Then get with their friends. They are, of course, ginger, sporty, scary, baby, and posh, the all-conquering Spice Girls!
Yeah. Not only does the crowd sound like a blistering Arctic winter wind, look at the confidence of the girls as they perform here. They fucking kill it. Wanna be my lover. Oh my god, the tasteful beat switch up, the confidence oozing out of them. Yes, girls! I could talk about this video all day. I think this is the Spice Girls at the height of their powers. That fake out from Wannabe into Who Do You Think You Are is magnifico. It's also on this evening that the world gets revealed to the Union Jack dress. that dress alone is almost as iconic as Wannabe. It permanently tied the Spice Girls to like 90s British cool. The Spice Girls never escaped it. For the rest of their career, you see the Union flag following them around. And I honestly think it's fair to say that at this point, the Spice Girls become intertwined with British identity. And I don't think that's exaggeration either. I think the British public really just lost their mind for the Spice Girls that evening in 1997. But even if they weren't wearing the Union flag dress, this performance is killer. I'm going to play the final moments now. Watch how Mel C rips through the oversinging, and look how much fun every single one of them appears to be having. I love this clip. It's the Spice Girl peak. It's so good.
Spice world. Bitch.
Okay, let's talk about 1997's Spice World era. Trying to understand how busy the Spice Girls were in 1997 is mind-boggling. Their manager, Simon Fuller, was pushing them extremely hard. They recorded the Spice World album on the set of Spice World the movie, like at the same time. Plus, there were documentary crews and behind the scenes for both the album and the film. In a single day, they would wake up at 6:30 in the morning, be on set and filming from 7:30, straight through to 5 p.m, at which point they'd stop filming, go to the recording studio and work on the album until 11 p.m, and then repeat that the next day.
Obviously, it's been some long days.
They've been very professional. We've kept absolutely to schedule.
The schedule is so tight, we even had to rehearse in the dressing room.
During making this film, we have done loads of things at the same time. There's always people coming down, you know, whether it's magazines, competition winners, whether it's, you know, promotion.
You know, if they're not doing this, they're having to do publicity or commercials or recording the next album.
It's been organised chaos, like we've been recording the album.
And when they weren't working on the album or the film, they were promoting. In a 2-week time frame, in October 1997, they visited Singapore, Bangkok, Delhi, Hong Kong, Tokyo, Granada, Cologne, Paris, London, Johannesburg, and played a large show in Istanbul. Again, that was in 2 weeks.
Oh yeah, and don't forget fitting in a number of music videos, which also had behind the scenes access for the media.
So you work so hard, you're gonna be working so hard. When's your next day off then? Go on then, working out from today, when is your next day off?
My next day off is next Sunday.
And do you know what you're going to do?
Do you know what I'll probably do on my next day off? I'll probably have to practice my dance routine.
Spice World the album came out before Spice World the film, in November 1997. Let's take a look at the music.
Although they worked with the same people to make the second album, there was a very different feel because they were on a strict time limit. On the first record, songs would emerge naturally from the girls in the studio. On the second album, they had a mobile studio in a Winnebago, and they would just cobble tracks together from whichever girl was available at any given time. The single was all ready to go, but nothing existed to be a B-side. There was nothing recorded because everyone's tracks had been used up on the album and they needed something right away. So they said, okay, just get the girls to do anything, anything you like. So we told them to talk, just talk about anything. We set up 4 microphones and recorded them all talking to each other and then put some hideous bubblegum backing track down behind their voices and somehow pieced it all together.
Information line, never leave your knickers on. Oh, hold on a minute, that's my phone.
Hello?
not always on the phone. I used to be always on the phone, but now I'm not because I've got ear rot.
What the fuck? It's a good thing, then, that the A-side to that single was Spice Up Your Life. Spice Up Your Life was a massive hit. It entered the charts at number one and made the Spice Girls the first group ever to reach number one with their first five singles, and the first group ever to enter the charts at number one four times in a row. But more than that, it's a fucking banger. The track has a Latin-inspired beat. Do you get it? Spice World, world music, very good. In fact, the lyrics are very directly addressing world music and people of the world. I love songs that are just lists of things. It's the best type of song. Also, check out this impressively poorly aged lyric they have in the second verse. Yellow man in Timbuktu, colorful both me and you. Yellow man in Timbuktu. You hear it and you're like, they can't mean that. But what else could yellow man mean, eh? But it doesn't even make sense. Timbuktu is in Africa. There's also an extremely poorly fitting music video that I've not shown you up until now because it's inspired by Blade Runner and shows the girls as rulers of this dystopian world where everything is Spice Girls. The girls themselves hated this music video and they wanted a video with a carnival theme, you know, to go with the colours and the fun music. So once again, the girls' instincts were right. But they were just too tired and overworked to fight back on it, so they let this video happen. The second single off the album was called Too Much. It also debuted at number one, making the girls the first band ever to have their first six singles go to number one. It's also where the cracks in the creative process really start to show. If you look at all of the interviews from around this time, it's just about how, oh, I came up with a cool line in the back of a car. Oh, Jerry ran into the Winnebago between shots and said, here's a line. I saw a cool t-shirt and thought, that could be a line. The result is that the lyrics can often feel
disjointed
line to line. And as you're listening to it, you'll find yourself thinking, like, what am I listening to? What does this mean? Unwrap yourself from around my finger. Hold me too tight. The song has its moments. I like when Mel C goes, understand, understand. I want a man, not a boy who thinks he
can. What the fuck is that? Is that a scene transition? Is it a dissolve? What is that?
Overall, there's like a treacly quality I do not like about the production. It sounds like melted marshmallow goop. The song isn't so bad that you notice any of this stuff at the first pass, but on repeated listens, you'll start to like it less and less.
And the same is true for the album at large.
The thinness of the material and the reliance on genre pastiche really becomes apparent as you start getting into the album. Get down, get deeper and down. That's the fourth song on the album, Saturday Night Divas. It's 4.5 minutes long, and just look at these lyrics. Get down, get deeper and down, get down, get deeper and down. Saturday night, get down, deeper and down, get down, get deeper and down. Saturday night. It's just quite a lot of getting down, getting deeper and down, getting down Saturday night.
It doesn't sound like you're listening to songs. It sounds like you're listening to ideas for songs.
There's a Motown one. This was the third single, and it peaked at number 2. Gasp! Shock horror! It's fine. Do you want to know what's not fine, though? Do you remember how on the last record, they had a bunch of leftover songs and they just gave one of them to Pepsi as a promotional gimmick? On this record, they were so pressed for material, they took an advert that they had already done for Pepsi, made it a full-length song, and put it on the album! That was a TV advert I just showed you. And this is it as track number 6 on the album. For context, Generation Next was a Pepsi commercial. And Move Over was an existing jingle. The Spice Girls took an advertising jingle, turned it into a full song, and put that on the album. Yeah. Listen, I'm all for securing the bag, but don't put that shit on your album, Jesus Christ! There's another problem that becomes apparent on the second album as well. This one's a little bit more subtle. Again, you don't notice it at first. The album sounds great at first, but after a while you notice there's no edge to it. Allow me to explain. On that first record, they knew that they were sort of targeting preteens, but they also knew that they could get away with a few coy nods and winks, a few M is in the place and she likes it in your face. That's a reference to cunnilingus. But something happened after that first album released. I explained before how the characters of
Scary, Sporty, Baby, Ginger, and Posh
were really effective. And they seeped into people's minds, people very instinctively understood. In fact, they were so easy to understand that even little girls gravitated towards it, like 5-year-olds, 6-year-olds. And the Spice Girls were really cool about it. They always, like, liked that young people liked their music. But they also knew they couldn't go around saying stuff like, "I'm cool and sexy and I know you want to get with me," if that's the audience. What this translates to is the second album is really sexless and edgeless and instead just has platitudes. This isn't to say that I think that the Spice Girls need to be making filthy, sexually explicit music in order for it to be good, but rather, there's just less to hold on to. The girls are being less authentic, they're having less fun, and it comes across, there's just less to the music. I don't think that Spice World is a bad album. In fact, I think it's a miracle that it holds together nearly as well as it does, given that the girls were so obviously overworked and tired by this point. I think part of it is that I'm overthinking a pop record for 8-year-old girls. But I overthought that first record as well, and I'd put that forward for genuine critical reassessment. Think about it like this. The girls wrote most of that first record before they got signed to Virgin or before they met Simon Fuller, their manager. And they spent a couple of years really crafting it, getting their image right and saying what they wanted to say. And I just can't shake the feeling that this second record is less like that and more like The Spice Girls Summer Brochure, or 1 Hour of Girl Power VHS Tape. in that it's just a product for fans to buy as part of Simon Fuller's marketing strategy. And there are some tunes on it, but there's just less magic, there's less to come back to, and there's less art.
Mel, Jerry, Emma, Vicky, and other Mel, I relegate you to Tat Corner.
Yes. There is one small question that comes into my mind. Can any of you act?
That's just put that right there. Just put that.
Spice World the movie, on the other hand, kicks ass. I mean it from my heart, this film is great. It is an all-time classic of so bad it's good movies. It's up there with Troll 2.
Hold on to your knickers, girls!
This is maybe the most quotable film that's ever existed, and if you watch it, you will find yourself saying lines from the movie.
Don't have a life, you have a schedule.
Well done, girls. Excellent performance.
What are you talking about? You weren't even watching Clifford.
Yes, I was.
Don't lie. No, you weren't.
I sense the vibes. I have an excellent vibe sensor right here.
Yeah, right.
I sensed the vibes. I have an excellent vibe sensor right here. I'm not going to bother talking about the plot, because if I was talking about the plot, it would be missing what makes this film magical. Instead, I'm going to give you a numbered list of reasons of why this film is magical. What do the numbers mean? Nothing.
Number one!
Celebrity cameos from the 90s. This film is a who's who of late 90s celebrities. You've got Jules Holland, Elton John, Jonathan Ross, Gary Glitter. Okay, to be fair and accurate, they did cut Gary's 4-minute long cameo sequence because he got caught with the child abuse pictures on his laptop right around this time. But the film was so threadbare that they weren't able to cut the extended sequence where the girls perform a Gary Glitter song. I won't give away all of the cameos, but Meatloaf is a bus driver.
Listen, I love these girls, and I'll do anything for them, but I won't do that.
Reason number two that you should rent this film on VHS from the Pirate Bay is the sense of humour. The film is genuinely funny, and that sounds sarcastic maybe, and I don't know how else to say it, but it is actually funny.
So this is the plan. The band starts up, the fans go wild, the lights come on, and I walk center stage and hang myself.
It catches you off guard, like this scene where the Spice Girls are pitched as crime fighters for a film.
The explosives expert.
Reason number three, just all of Victoria.
Hello, Malcolm, it's Jerry.
I'm Melanie C.
And I'm Victoria, Malcolm.
Shh, stop it.
Same, I never know what to wear.
Yeah, it must be really hard for you, Victoria. You know, trying to decide whether to wear the little Gucci dress, the little Gucci dress, or the little Gucci dress.
Exactly.
I know. Why don't you wear the little Gucci dress?
That's a good idea, thanks, Em.
I mean, there isn't a single subtle performance in the entire film, but Victoria just goes something else on it.
Help! What? This dress is dry clean only, Melanie!
Reason number four. The film comes out right at the peak of the Spice Girls' fame and cultural saturation. And it does pause to reflect on where the girls could feasibly go from the top. And there is a nightmare sequence about the girls not being relevant anymore, which hits a real weird note looking back on it 25 years later.
Melvin B, Emma, Melvin C, Victoria, get it. You have been found guilty of releasing a single that is by no means as kicking as your previous records. You are sentenced to having your next record enter the charts at number 179 before dropping straight out the following week.
What?
Furthermore, you are sentenced to 20 years of having to appear on cheesy chat shows in Taiwan talking about how you used to be famous. And may God have mercy on your lip gloss.
I didn't say it was deep commentary, but it counts. And finally, number 5. There's just something nice about the world that this film takes place in. It's set in the optimistic 90s version of London, which, like, I've been to the real 2021 version of London, okay? Trust me, the Spice World version of London is nicer. During the runtime of the film, you hang out on the Spice Bus, you go clubbing with the girls, you hit up some old cafes. It's a really, like, vibey hangout film. It's just nice. Unfortunately, the critics did not appreciate the vibey hangout nature of the film and fucking slaughtered it.
Oh no.
The great Roger Ebert here compares it to The Beatles' A Hard Day's Night. The Beatles film played off the personalities of the Beatles. The Spice Girls have no personalities. Their bodies are carriers for inane chatter. The Beatles film had such great music that every song in it is beloved all over the world. The Spice Girls' music is so bad that even Spice World avoids using any more of it than is absolutely necessary. Half a star. Spice World the movie comes out in December of 1997, so the whole world has had a full year of Spice Girls' tat being shoved down their throats. Spice Girls Summer Secrets cassette, come on, come the fuck on. A backlash is growing in the media, but luckily the Spice Girls have a crack PR team under Simon Fuller's management, right? Right? He guided them to the top. So why did they do it? One rumor is that they hated Spice World and blamed Simon. The salacious rumor that was popular at the time was that Simon was shagging Emma, and Jerry and Mel B weren't happy about this. But I think that's a load of old bollocks. No, I think it's as simple as Simon was very controlling and overworked them. During the insane promotional schedule for Spice World, Jerry begged Simon Fuller for a week off, and every time Simon would tell her off like a naughty schoolchild. And as the architect of girl power herself, Jerry gave Simon the axe. I mean, the whole group did it, but it was almost certainly Jerry and Mel B as a coalition. They actually sacked him before the premiere of Spice World the movie, so even though it was directed by his brother, he didn't attend. Initially, the girls felt really good about sacking Simon, and they've never expressed regret on the matter. But it did make their exhaustion worse in the long term, because they just made a whole lot more work for themselves where they have to manage themselves and book dates and arrange interviews and everything like that. And unfortunately, they lost all of Simon's contacts as well, like the PR guy and the merchandise guy, so they were in a much worse position going forwards. The Spice Girls story has a lot in common with the Beatles, and one similarity is that once the manager goes, the things start to fall apart. But also, like the Beatles, it doesn't happen immediately, because they've still got momentum, right? They kick him out, and he was the engine that was carrying the girls forward, but they still have momentum, including all of the events that had been booked for them coming up, including World Tour, baby! 3 legs, 56 shows in Europe, 41 shows in North America, grossing over $60 million. The show was very high budget, with singing, dancing, stage banter, costume changes, and
Je voudrais une double.
I want a double. Wouldn't that be good?
It would be good if we had a double. Because then...
wouldn't have to get out of bed.
No, we wouldn't.
What's that?
There we go.
What's this?
What is this?
The tour footage that I've got is from their dates in France, and after they've run out of saying bonjours and bonsoirs, they resort to just making noises.
Bonjour.
It is at this point that I am reminded that I love the Spice Girls. They're so good.
Cheeky, come on, monkeys. Shoo! Cheeky boys!
Cheeky monsters!
Where's Mel?
Da?
Where's B gone again?
B's right here.
Is
check
she?
This out.
Hey!
Hey!
Hey.
I've got the horn!
Look at this raw, pure, grinning mug. This must be the biggest smile that's ever been recorded on Victoria Beckham. They did actually perform music as part of their live show. It wasn't all just stage banter. But people liked the Spice Girls as people, so the stage banter was a large part of it.
Never mind the performances or the stage banter. There's a very important question that needs to be asked. Did they manage to shoehorn Pepsi into their live show? Yes, they did!
My God, these bitches invented vaporwave.
The tour was going great. They'd sold out 20 UK arenas. They'd completed most of Europe. But there was trouble brewing in Spice World. It turns out singing and dancing and bantering for 2 hours every night, plus travelling and setup, is exhausting. Do you remember earlier when I said Jerry wanted some time off? Well, it turns out Jerry really wanted some time off.
Thanks for coming along. It's really nice to see you all, but are we not missing somebody?
We are. Unfortunately, Jerry's not very well tonight, so get well soon, Jerry.
Get well soon, Jerry.
This is the face of someone who knows that they are lying on national television. Jerry is not sick. Jerry is gone.
There's trouble in Spice World this lunchtime. It's being claimed that Jerry Halliwell, or Ginger Spice, has left the group.
So where is Ginger Spice? Did Jerry Halliwell jump or was she pushed?
Ginger Spice is missing. But is she planning to go solo or is she simply off colour?
For 1 week, the girls kept up the Jerry is ill lie, performing without her and hoping that she'd come back to the group. But she did not.
Days of speculation were about to end. The camera crews were so tightly packed, representatives for the Spice Girls had problems squeezing onto the pavement. First, Jerry's lawyer.
I have no immediate plans. I wish to apologise to all the fans and to thank them and everyone who's been there. Lots of love, Jerry. P.S. I'll be back.
Jerry leaving completely blindsided the other Spice Girls.
and they had to perform the rest of the tour without Jerry. The rest of the tour being 41 dates in America and Wembley Stadium in London. It's worth me pointing out at this point, the Spice Girls were actual friends. Like, they had lived together for years before they made it as the Spice Girls, like before Wannabe came out. And Jerry really blindsided them in a way that caused bitterness that is still known today.
It was just, I felt like, you know, why'd you do that to the Spice Girls? The way she left.
Yeah.
I mean, did she tell you guys?
Or no.
When you found out the reason she had done that, it's obviously because she wasn't in a good place.
But we didn't find that out till way after.
Did that make it better for you? That you could understand why she did that then? You still couldn't?
No, because I just think I wouldn't have done that.
With any band, if a member leaves, it can be quite difficult for the fans. But with the Spice Girls, they were a unit. They had girl power uniting them. All of their songs were about looking after each other. The Spice Girls were an atom. They were indivisible. And Jerry betrayed that.
Ah! I don't believe it. Not Jerry. Jerry's my favourite. Jerry's the one that keeps it all together. She's the one with the bounce, the go, girl power. Not Jerry. Why?
I think everything was fine with Five. And now that Jerry's leaving, She's sort of letting the whole country down.
Prince Charles wrote to Jerry saying, "The group will not be the same without you."
Seriously?
The Spice Girls adapted to being a four-piece and completed their tour without Jerry. But they were totally exhausted. Touring famously sucks anyway, and doing it without a friend and having to make up for an extra person's work and not having a manager to make your life easier, that's gonna doubly suck, if not triply suck. The tour culminated in a sold-out show at Wembley Stadium, the dream of any British band. But it was bittersweet, and by the time it was all over, the girls just wanted to stop. And once they stopped for just a moment, all the momentum from their rocket fuel ascent left them.
So you're in a band and you're back from a year-long tour. You don't have a manager and your best friend and founding member is gone. What do you do? You turn inwards and focus on yourself. Mel B is the first girl to release a solo project. Partnering with Missy Elliott, she releases a single with a more urban hip-hop sensibility. Victoria Adams gets married to David Beckham and also gets knocked up. Though not in that order, Emma puts out a single. Jerry emerges from hibernation. After auctioning off her Spice Girls memorabilia, she releases a music video that officially kills the character of Ginger Spice. Mel C puts her passions towards a solo album, vying for authenticity as she's sick of being punched down upon in the press, and, like, to be fair, it was really bad. The only highlight from this Twilight era is in Christmas of 1999, where they play some live shows called Christmas in Spice World. It was aired on British TV. They may have been singing Merry Christmas songs on stage, but behind the scenes, not everybody was having fun. Their third album was Tearing Them Apart, a passionless project where Mel C was out of the studio to pursue her solo album, and Mel B and Victoria were preoccupied by motherhood. They had chosen to drop their normal songwriters and producers, instead opting for Rodney Jenkins, who was hot off of his work with Destiny's Child. The album had a new direction, and it wasn't necessarily a bad idea either, TLC themselves had gone down this route with their second two albums.
A scrub is a guy that thinks he's flying, is also known as a buster.
The difference is that when TLC did it, they had more than one good song. Spice World, for all its flaws, was an album where the girls were clearly giving it everything that they could give. Forever just sounds like going through the motions. It's lame. This album sounds lame. That's lame. That chorus is lame. Sucks. The album severely underperformed. There was a famously tumultuous launch party, and as the girls were as unenthusiastic about promoting the album as they were recording it, they decided to just walk away from the project at Christmas of 2000. And just like that, unceremoniously, the Spice Girls were over, leaving behind one of the most ironically named albums of all time.
I want to be a pop star.
The real question at the heart of this video is, why are they in such a weird position culturally? They're not forgotten, but they're not remembered either. Compare the Spice Girls with another 90s institution like Friends, and the mystery that I'm talking about becomes obvious. Friends is beloved to this day, with near constant reruns and a huge anniversary this year that featured Lady Gaga and it was on the front page of Twitter. The Spice Girls were just as big as Friends, but you don't see half of the conversation. Everyone in Britain knows of the Spice Girls.
They are a genuine chapter of British history, a little corner of cultural identity to this day. But it seems like the things that made them popular in the first place have been forgotten or not passed on. And why is that? I think the most obvious answer is cultural saturation. They were too popular and too ubiquitous, and people got burnt out. They flooded the UK with all of these tie-in branded products, which were a load of old rubbish. And the result is that people viewed the Spice Girls as solely a vehicle for merchandise sales. And it left a very bad taste in the public's mouth. But that was a long time ago, and the product tie-ins should be forgotten. If you listen to Spice World now, you wouldn't even know that Move Over was about Pepsi unless I told you. Another reason that gets bandied about with the Spice Girls is that they're too inauthentic, that all their material was written for them, and they were simply pop shills. But that's not true. They worked with songwriters. No other group in the world could have written Wannabe. Like, compare that with Elvis, who didn't write shit, and you still know him as the king. Pop music is filled with acts who were popular at the time and achieved chart success, became a critical punchline, and then years later became popular again after that backlash fades. Take ABBA or The Carpenters, for example.
And I would say that musically, the Spice Girls belong in that lineage. They wrote good pop music.
And it feels like we're due a reassessment, a reevaluation. Where is it? One theory I have is that there's just not enough material. ABBA has 7 classic albums. The Carpenters have 9. The Spice Girls have 2. Even if you're a die-hard Spicer, there's just not that much for you to listen to. Imagine if the Beatles had fired Brian Epstein after they made A Hard Day's Night, and then John left in 1965. That's more or less the position that the Spice Girls are actually in. And I also think that they really screwed themselves over by acquiring the 4-8 demographic. It may have made them money in the short term, but if you're seen as baby music, you're never going to be cool. That first album shot them to superstardom, but they reached the peak of their cultural saturation around the second album cycle. So the living memory of the group is one that permanently paints them as children's music, and that's a death sentence to your legacy. but I would like to put forward that people should think of them more positively.
The light that burns twice as bright burns half as long, and you have burned so very, very brightly.
Their instincts for style and presentation were second to none, and they had a genuine ear for melody. The word iconic gets used a lot, but so much of what the Spice Girls did was iconic. The girl power slogan, the peace hands, the Wannabe music video, Wannabe, the Brit performance, Spice Up Your Life, Spice World the movie, even the Spice personas, even the girls themselves. The first Spice Girls album is one that I would posit as important to music history. On 1996's Spice, they are a group that is truly like no other. They're being authentically themselves and they're having fun with it. There is an edge, a cheekiness, a confidence, and they present something real and fresh on that record. Something that people in the 90s connected with, and that you can still feel if you listen to it now. And if people don't recognise that, at least I can take comfort in the fact that I have stared into the smiling, spicy face of the 90s and I have seen beauty. So, as a convert to the Church of Spice, I decided to take a trip to where it all began and pay my respects to these iconic legends.
It was at this spot, 25 years ago, that Emma Bunton stole a homeless person's hat. Why did she do that?
Spice Girls!
Like the Spice Girls!